Hello, everybody. Welcome to Old Tales of Nevada, past and present. Glad to have you with us this week. We have a great show in store. We'll be talking about atomic energy and the testing of the atomic bomb right here in the state of Nevada. So stay tuned. We have the whole story for you right after this.
Hi there. I'm here, Roy Marshall of the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada. I'm proud to announce that our 7-ingot set honoring the V&T Railroad is now finished.
That's right, Uroy. These beautiful 999 silver ingots celebrate the engines from the world-famous V&T Railroad and honor Nevada's sesquicentennial. These limited edition treasures can be purchased only at the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada.
Or visit us at marshallmint.com to get yours today.
All of us at Schumann's Custom Cycle are ready to get you and your Harley ready for the road. From oil and tire changes to high-performance engine upgrades and dyno tuning, we at Schumann's have got you covered with experienced factory-certified mechanics and a full-service machine shop loaded with parts and accessories. Schumann's Custom Cycle has been serving Northern Nevada since 1988. So ride on down to Schumann's Custom Cycle at 275 East 4th Street in downtown Reno.
Schumann's Custom Cycle. We're the biker's bike shop.
Welcome, everybody, to Old Tales of Nevada, past and present. I'm John O'Brien, the host of the show, my sidekick as usual, and a big benefactor for Old Tales of Nevada, Uroy Marshall. Uroy,
how you doing, Donnie?
Welcome to the show. Yeah. It's been a couple of weeks since we've been together.
I know it.
And you're looking better than ever.
Well, I haven't fell off any shafts lately.
Oh, no, that's good. That's
really helped my back situation immensely.
No. You better get that fixed, huh?
No, I get little back problems. I broke my back. I fell on a big rock.
Yeah, that's not a good thing. Not a good thing. Well, anyway, it's good to have you here.
Yeah.
Our special guest today is Bill Quick. And what an opportunity it is for us to have Bill on the show. Bill, welcome to the show, first of all.
Yeah.
Good to have you with us.
You betcha.
And we're going to be talking today about his knowledge of the atomic energy development here in the United States. And he was right there in ground zero.
Yeah. You know, I have several friends that were at ground zero, and almost none of them are left.
Yeah, I know.
But my attorney in Washington, Sylvan Marshall, he photographed it.
Some of the
out there as it occurred.
Some of the testing
here. He was a reporter at the time.
No kidding. Wow. Wow. Well, before we get to you, Bill, we want to go to Uroy, because Uroy always tells us why we do the show and what he's doing up there on the Comstock in particular. So we're going to turn it over to you for a few minutes there, Uroy.
You betcha. Well, we do this show to bring pride to the people who live in the state of Nevada and also in the western part of our great United States of America. Because this is a very, very important state, the Nevada state, in that the Nevada state, at the time of the Civil War, became the benefactor of the first United States of America, which was formed after Abraham Lincoln. We owed more than what we were worth to France, Germany, and England.
Yes, sir.
And they, at that time, would have taken over the United States, and we would have been France, Germany, and England if the Comstock Big Bonanza boys wouldn't have donated, but they donated about $8.5 million.
Yeah,
and something. Rounded up money from a number of other people donated too.
Mm-hmm.
That gave Abraham the chance to get started, and then we also developed the dollar bill here. I mean, the U.S. dollar,
yeah,
which was the Carson City Mint product that basically began the revolution of really the whole world, because now silver is very important, and every gadget and every little thing that we have has silver in it, making it work.
Exactly.
And we use more than what we're worth, but more than what we have, too, also. But silver at that time of the Comstock era was a very important mineral and metal.
Yeah.
It is. Our photography got developed from that. People ate off of it.
Yeah. Yeah, and it all happened right there in the Comstock. We had a seminar the other day with all of the mills on the Carson River. It was pretty amazing stuff. You got a piece of rock there.
This is a piece of cobalt from Africa, which I have some young men down there that mine for me in some really awful holes, silver and gold. mostly in the native form, and then they get this for the king of Morocco, who is a friend of mine also. He owns this project.
He owns that project.
So this is cobalt. Basically, heavy water is created within the atomic
reactor
in such a way that the cobalt basically becomes radioactive and forms the heavy water that is in the plant.
Okay, so I see you have that wrapped up.
It's poisonous stuff.
It's poisonous to
just
well,
don't.
You can hold it then. It's all yours.
Yeah, you don't want to hold it, handle it, and then eat off of it.
Oh, okay.
Also, same effort is involved with radioactive
material, which is a big part of our theme today is radioactivity. But so we have all of this history in Nevada, right, you, Roy?
Mm-hmm.
And our purpose of the show is to bring this history to our audience here in northern mm-hmm. Nevada so they can develop pride in living in Nevada, which makes everybody happier, and you take better care of your fellow man and everything else that you do here in the local area, right?
Well, you know, the one big thing that Nevada produces is 10% of all the gold on the planet each
right.
year, which is very important to the balance of everybody's currencies.
Yes.
But we're sending all the gold that's produced here, mostly all in Taiwan. And
going somewhere.
Goes to China mostly.
Yeah. But what a state we live in. We have so many resources in the ground.
Lithium batteries are going to come from these dry lake beds out here. You see down in the bottom of the dry lake bed. And they had to pump the water down there and then push it back up again and then take it out, lithium out of it, and then put the government makes put the water back.
Well, the technology that's been developed here in Nevada is also a reason for pride, too. But a big reason for our show is to focus on the people we have in northern Nevada, because we have some real gems, you know, and week after week we find people living with us who have had some tremendous lives and history to talk about. Great stories. And Bill Quick is one of these gems that we have right here in our midst. And Bill, again, want to welcome you to the show.
We appreciate you coming, Bill.
Yeah. Now, Bill, before we get into your experiences with atomic energy, let me just ask you, you've been in Reno how long now?
At this time, 15 years.
15 years, and you came from where?
I came from Southern California.
Southern California.
Lived there the longest.
Okay.
I spent 30 years in Southern California as a contractor.
Okay.
Building various sites, generally for the county of Los Angeles.
Oh, okay.
They're all seal bid jobs.
Okay.
And
had your own company down there?
Yes.
Oh, that a boy. So are you originally from Southern California area?
No, I'm originally from upstate New York.
Hey, that a boy.
Yeah. How about that?
I'm a Jersey boy myself, you know. What town in upstate New York?
Johnstown, Gloversville.
All right. A lot of snow, huh?
A lot of snow. Cold winters.
You get that lake effect snow over there,
oh,
right?
Yeah.
For sure. Yeah. Well, I'm glad you're from the East Coast. But, you know, just like me, we find our way out west and we wind up in Reno, Nevada, and we can't leave, right?
Yeah.
But anyway, so you you came out to the West. How old were you when you came out to the West? Did you come out with the family?
No, I came out by myself. After I graduated from high school, in which I was 18 years old, I picked up a buddy that I went to school with, and he and I just bummed across the country.
No kidding.
In those days, you could hitchhike any place. It was pretty safe.
You hitchhiked, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Now, what highway would you follow coming in? Oh, was it Highway 40? Highway?
I don't remember some of those roads. Some were the same
75.
As today.
But 75.
But very few of them.
Yeah.
The road,
Route 66?
We didn't have the roads. When I came across, was in, I guess, 1949.
49.
Yeah.
Wow, you were just a young whippersnapper back then.
Oh, yeah. Just looking for adventure.
Yeah. Because your age now is 90, right? You're 90 years old now.
98.
You're 98 years old?
No.
88.
Oh, 88. I was going to say you look pretty darn good for 98.
88.
98 is getting pretty good.
Yeah.
So anyway, you get to Southern California, right? and you need work.
Now, how I got to Southern California, you have to explore every in and out if you want to go somewhere. I saw an ad in the newspaper, and men needed for Pacific Islands, you know.
Yeah.
So Bill, contact so and so in Los Angeles.
Uh huh.
So I did that. I was only, well, I guess I was 18 years old then.
That was your first job. They
yeah.
And you wanted to go to the Marshall Islands.
Yeah, I wanted to go where there was some action.
That's what I thought you were going to say, Marshall Islands.
Yeah, Marshall Islands.
I went in that office hiring hall in Los Angeles and met this woman who did some of the hiring. She interviewed you. She looked at me, and one of the stipulations was that you'd have 5 years form experience.
Okay.
And she looked at me, and she says, "Son, I don't think you've had 5 years form experience." And I said, "Well, I guess I have a little less than that."
Like none, right?
She says, "Well, it was a good try, wasn't it?" I says, "Yeah." And I started to walk out, and she says, "Say, we need helpers on our projects out there. Would you like to go as a helper?"
Yeah.
I said, "Sure would."
No problem.
Yeah.
And what was the pay back in those days?
You won't believe it. I look back at myself and I say, "My God, how could they hire people for that kind of pay?"
Yeah.
$1.20 an hour.
Woohoo! $1.20.
And
way
we
to
were
go.
Guaranteed 9 hours a day, 6 days a week.
No kidding. Well, where else would you go? I mean, you. So.
But on top of that, we got all our expenses paid. We
yeah.
got three meals a day and snacks. And you never ate such good food in your life.
That's,
I mean, the food there had to be served at the best hotels in Las Vegas.
No kidding.
Oh, yeah.
How did they get you from L.A. to the Marshall Islands? Was it by boat or by plane?
By plane.
By plane. Oh,
yeah.
Wow. That
yeah.
must have been what? Like 20 hours on the plane at least?
Well, I don't know. They
long time.
They bust us into a military base just out of Los Angeles and kept us there for a couple of days till they got a plane ready to take about 25 or 30 of us at a time.
Yeah.
Out there, and we flew. We flew out. I'm trying to think of the stops we made.
Probably Guam, Hawaii, all of those, huh?
Well, yeah, we stopped in Hawaii overnight. And then went on. That wasn't very exciting.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we got to a military base way out, and I can't remember.
Midway? Was it Midway or Guam?
No.
No?
It was one you probably never heard of before. And we got off there. We spent the night there, had supper there. And as a young boy, I love to eat. And some of those soldiers that were stationed there, I guess they got pretty tired of the food. They said, "You don't eat that food." I thought the food was good.
We're going to take a break right here, and then we'll come back, and we'll get you on that Marshall Island. You can tell us what happened there. So stay tuned for more Old Tales of Nevada, past and present, right after this.
For our cold winter days, jackets and vests are the perfect answer. Faux fur and faux leather are the strong fabrics for this season. Team them with maxi skirts for a beautiful seasonal look. All of this and so much more at Boutique Elegante.
Buy Nevada First Gift Shop and Visitor Center at the Reno Town Mall is the place to buy local Nevada-owned products. There is over 4,000 square feet of unique items to choose from. Art, jewelry, books, music, inventions, clothing, candy, pottery, toys, even Nevada-made wine and more. Why, you can even purchase a gift basket full of Nevada-owned products. Buy Nevada First Gift Shop, located at the Reno Town Mall, 4001 Virginia Street in Reno. Buy local first.
Hi, I'm Paula.
And I'm Dan. We're the producers of the Tanner's Marketplace Antiques and Craft Shows at the Livestock Events Center on Wells Avenue.
I'd also like to tell you about our everyday location. We're at Somewhere in Time on South Virginia Street. We're Antique Antiques, booth number 46.
You'll find paintings by Nevada artists, collectible glass, vintage jewelry, Native American jewelry and baskets, antiques and unusual to unique items.
Find it all at Antique Antiques inside Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street.
Come see us!
The beautiful fall colors are being duplicated in the fall collection of fashions at Boutique Elegante. Sweaters are either in the crayon colors for fall or soft muted shades in bark and beige. All of this and so much more at Boutique Elegante.
Hi, I'm Chris from Past Time at Somewhere in Time. Are you looking for that one-of-a-kind gift that you can't find in the big department store? I have something for all occasions. Got stuff? Need to know whether or not it has value or how to sell it? We can help with that too. Come and see me Tuesday or Wednesday at Past Time and Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street in Reno. Just ask for Chris.
We're back here in Old Tales of Nevada, past and present, talking with Bill Quick, a 90-year-old man, young-looking 90 years old, I might say, who was in the midst of the nuclear energy development for the United States. And as we left our last segment, you were just getting to the Marshall Islands. So let's get you there. You went to the Marshall Islands. What atoll were you on? Was it the Bikini Atoll, or are you in that other one?
The Aniwetok.
Aniwetok, yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, they put you up in a hotel there, right? Well, what was conditions like there for you when you got there?
Well, we had pretty nice Quonset huts and good tents. They had some permanent barracks that housed four men, uh-huh. four beds. They were all very comfortable.
Oh, good.
There was no place that at that time that they put us up that was uncomfortable.
Well, good. So they took care of you that way. What was the environment there? Was it a desert island, or was it more of your, you know, green, jungly type of...
No, it was more of a desert island, because during the Second World War, most of the vegetation had been destroyed off of it.
That's right, because they had a
battle. Big battles there.
Exactly.
Killed hundreds and hundreds of people there.
Yeah, yeah.
And we dug them up all the time.
Wow. Oh, that must not have been a great experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. You're out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, I was looking on the map, the world map, and it's east of the Philippines by a number of miles, northeast of Australia, and you're just kind of out there. And so when you got there, you were there for a while. You didn't just, you know, commute. You had to be prepared to stay on that island for quite a while, correct?
No. The way they had things worked out, they need certain classifications of men here.
Oh, I see.
Where they could, they might work on this job on an island for a couple of days. Then they boat them to another island that need work that they can do, and they moved around that way.
Okay.
That saved having a lot of personnel over there that they didn't need.
Right.
They now, utilized everything and everybody.
Everybody. Now, you were telling me, or it was written, that some of the guys had a hard time on these islands because you're right there, and the ocean's, of course, there, and the ocean makes noise, and some of the guys that worked there couldn't handle the roar of the sea. That was just constant. Is that right?
That's what you call going rock.
Going
rock happy.
Rock happy.
And I saw many of them. And they claimed, in the figures I've read, that one-third of all the men they sent there could never finish contract.
Isn't that
Because they couldn't stand the environment that you had to live in.
Wow, isn't that amazing?
Know? Yeah. You got to remember, you're on little islands that are, oh, heck. Some of them are only maybe 100, 150 feet across, 200 feet and long, maybe a couple of miles long, just long spits of land. And
wow.
You hear that roar
Yeah.
From those breakers constantly. It never stops.
Amazing.
You go to sleep with it, you wake up with it, you get used to it, or you get out of there.
You probably still remember it very well, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
That sound, yeah. Now, let me ask you this. The work that you did was rather important because you became a crane operator, and you had the opportunity to actually move the bomb that they tested there. So tell us about that experience. I mean, how did you feel about that opportunity? Was that, it must have been kind of scary for you, right? They weren't sure how stable this thing was, right?
No, you know, I look back at those days and what we were doing, and I thought, nothing to that, nothing to that. I mean, you're just a young, impetuous kid.
Yeah.
Nothing scared you.
Yeah, yeah.
And
mortality was not a problem.
One important thing that happened, they'd already built a tower that was the first hydrogen bomb.
Hydrogen bomb?
Yeah.
Okay.
And was going to be detonated from. And they laid some tracks out a ways from the bomb. And the other tracks would have to come from the direction of coming in from the lagoon, from the ocean, with that. And when they went to use that and put it together, I think men that work there are going to remember all kinds of different things that aren't going to be the same.
Yeah.
Because you try to think back that many years.
Yeah,
and
it's a long time.
But these tracks, although they were the same gauge, they were far enough away that they didn't quite meet perfectly. And they were going to be having the world's first hydrogen bomb riding on them, and they didn't want to bump it.
I guess not.
So that's when I come in.
Yeah.
We had a heavy equipment superintendent there, awful nice man, and he come over and got me, and he says, "Bill, you want a good little job for a while?" "Well, what's it?" And he says, "I want you to pick up the bomb from that side on those tracks. Just move it over here a few feet and set it down in the tracks above it. They're both the same gauge, but they're enough off that you're going to feel a bump if we ride over it."
Whoa.
"And we don't want to bump it."
Right.
So I said, "Sure, be glad to do that." Because this crane I operated, I had been operating it for, some 6 months. I knew everything about it, how it felt and everything.
Yeah.
And, but when the time come to pick it up, all of a sudden I hear one man yelling his head off, cursing, Get that kid off of that crane, and you get a seasoned operator up there going to move the hydrogen bomb."
Yeah.
Because I was only then, like, I guess 20 years old.
Yeah.
And but the thing is, I'd been working on that crane and been trained on that crane for the last 5-6 months.
So you knew better than anybody.
Well, yeah. I knew the frictions.
Yeah.
I could pick it up and never jumps it around or nothing.
Yeah, yeah.
And this heavy equipment superintendent had to explain it to this guy yelling, and the guy yelling, he was higher up in the way of work than this guy was, but he finally calmed him down, and it was just a matter. They put it on a sled in the frame and hooked it up, and you just had to boom over to it, hook it up and pick it up off the ground and move it over 5 or 6 feet and set it back down.
Yeah, no problem.
Very simple thing, you know.
How big was the bomb? I'm curious. Was it as big as this table? Was
that particular bomb? There's pictures of that.
Yeah.
Maybe not that big.
Really?
Maybe twice the size of this table.
No kidding. Wow.
Yeah.
Heavy? Was it heavy?
I guess it was.
Yeah, because you had to use a crane to move it.
Well, it was heavy, that heavy, yeah.
Yeah.
Weighed hundreds of pounds.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, but.
So let me ask you this. So how did they get it from the rail car up 200 feet? Did they have like an elevator shaft that took it up there and set it on the tower?
Well, they took it on the tracks. Then on the where the tracks ended, right inside the tower.
Yeah.
Is where they had the cranes.
Okay.
Set up with lines on them, and that's where they operated from.
Okay. So you get it up on the tower.
You could just walk. There was guys goofing off all day long that would walk that knew how to run that crane in the tower, walk on that tower and push the button and go up in the air. You know, a lot of fun.
A lot of fun.
They did that all the time.
So they get it up there on top of the tower. Of course, then they have to arm the thing, right? Did you have anything to do with arming that hydrogen bomb?
No. I used to spend a lot of time watching what they were doing and talking to four or five physicists that armed it.
No. Okay.
And one of them said to me one day, I don't remember his name, but you get acquainted with people. And he said, I noticed he picked up a machine part. I can't tell you what that was. A couple of nuts screwed together or something, and he kind of dropped them down on the floor on purpose.
On purpose.
And he says, Bill, he says, would you pick that up for me? Well, sure. I'm only 20 years old. He's a 65-year-old physicist.
Yeah.
And handed it to him, and he looked at me, and he says, now you can tell your kids and grandkids, you helped arm the world's first hydrogen bomb.
Oh, my goodness. Wow. That is, well, that is an experience to never forget. Did they have a name for that bomb? Like, you know, did they call it Little Billy or
yeah,
whatever?
They had a name. I can't remember the name. Probably got them at home in some memorabilia that's written down. But they had names. Everyone had a name.
Yeah. How many bombs did they actually explode off of those islands?
Oh, my God. Before they were through, there were, I think, just over 90.
90? Wow.
Yeah.
That's pretty amazing. That must have just devastated that area for you. Well, still.
The first ones they bombed, the first ones were ground shots. They blew them from the top of the ground.
Oh, yeah.
It came, the big mushroom.
Yeah.
A lot of radiation.
Yeah.
But then they got more careful. They even exploded one under a false, what was it? They built an installation and put a bomb down under it.
Wow.
And blew it all to pieces.
Isn't that something?
But most of them, they blew them from smaller towers,
above
some big towers. And you were back, 5 or 6 miles from ground zero.
Wow.
At times you got a little too close and got too much radiation, and then they had to put you, I don't know what they did with them.
Okay, let me take a break here. I want to hear where you, how you experienced that when it exploded. That'd be fun to hear. Back with more Old Tales of Nevada right after we hear from a couple of our great sponsors for the show.
We bought our building, lower the overhead. That means everyday low prices to you. Merry Christmas from Precision Diamonds, your local jeweler.
Precision Diamonds.
Come and visit a whole new Precision Diamonds. Larger selection, lower prices, and a whole new way to serve you. Merry Christmas from Precision Diamonds, your local jeweler.
Precision Diamonds.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is the home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel, so stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
Hi, I'm Paula.
And I'm Dan. We're the producers of the Tanner's Marketplace Antiques and Craft Shows at the Livestock Events Center on Wells Avenue.
I'd also like to tell you about our everyday location. We're at Somewhere in Time on South Virginia Street. We're Antique Antiques, booth number 46.
You'll find paintings by Nevada artists, collectible glass, vintage jewelry, Native American jewelry and baskets, antiques and unusual to unique items.
Find it all at Antique Antiques inside Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street.
Come see us!
Hi, I'm Chris from Past Time at Somewhere in Time. Are you looking for that one-of-a-kind gift that you can't find in the big department store? I have something for all occasions. Got stuff? Need to know whether or not it has value or how to sell it? We can help with that, too. Come and see me Tuesday or Wednesday at Past Time in Somewhere in Time at 1313 South Virginia Street in Reno. Just ask for Chris.
Welcome back to Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. Just to remind everybody who we are, I'm John O'Brien, the host of the show. My sidekick, Uroy Marshall, with us this week. And our special guest, Bill Quick. And he is a man who experienced things that many of us hopefully never want to experience, and that is the explosion of an atomic bomb or a hydrogen bomb. Our last segment, we were talking about the explosion of the bomb, and you say you were only 5 to 6 miles away from ground zero. Yeah. What was that like, Bill? I mean, could you actually view it, and did you feel it when it
exploded?
Yeah,
vibrations from the bomb.
Oh, yeah, you could feel the heat. And sometimes, in those days, everything was crude. They didn't know exactly what the strength of a certain bomb was going to be. Uh-huh. They knew pretty close, but it really wasn't safe because the bomb could have a lot more power than what they thought.
Yeah.
And because I remember two or three times when the bomb went off, I went like this.
Yeah.
The heat, the shield from the heat.
Yeah.
Because we were probably only, 3 or 4 miles.
No kidding.
From those bombs.
Well, you're fortunate that you even survived it. Did people actually die from those?
I'm sure there's a lot of secrets buried today where men were injured terribly or killed.
Right.
In those bomb tests.
Sure. Had to be.
That they never broadcast.
They never told you because they didn't want to scare you
no,
off.
No, they didn't want to scare anybody.
Yeah, and you didn't know.
Did
you,
safe.
Did you know that there was radiation hazard at
time?
You
oh,
did.
Yeah.
But they figured if you ducked and covered and put glasses on, you were going to be okay.
They told us nothing to worry about.
Yeah. So there's you were saying to Uroy that you didn't have any, what you could detect, immediate effects from being that close to that many explosions?
No, I had no effects. Oh my goodness, for maybe 30 years.
30 years.
Oh, that was amazing.
Almost, yeah, 30 years. And then little by little, things just started happening to you.
Uh-huh. Was it cancer? Was it, or other physical?
It was other physical things.
Uh-huh.
I did finally have cancer, and that probably came from it, because I remember having surgery on one of the islands to cut the cancer out.
Okay.
And I survived that.
Wow.
And that all came from...
Oh, from that, absolutely, yeah.
What about your thyroid gland? Bill, that usually collects that.
I don't know about that.
Yeah.
No.
Well, anyway, you're doing pretty good at 90 years old, despite all of those explosions. How many explosions did you experience?
Oh, goodness.
Dozens.
Huh?
Dozens?
A dozen.
Yeah, at least
probably
that
many. Something like that.
Yeah. So when did you leave the islands and come back to the United States?
Well, I had a contract date, and when that was up, I had some fellows that I run around with there on the island or bunked with them, and they went over the same time, go back the same time. So we all got on a plane one day and properly flew to Honolulu.
Flew to Honolulu.
Then flew to Los Angeles.
Uh-huh.
And it was all over. Now, some of them signed up and went back.
Oh, okay.
But I'd had enough of it.
You had enough of it for a while, right? Yeah. Because now you're another experience you had beyond Marshall Islands was being at the Mercury site here in Southern Nevada, right?
Yeah.
What year was that?
As soon as I got back in 1951, they were advertising for men at Mercury.
Uh-huh.
And so I went up there, and you could go to work almost immediately.
Uh-huh.
Because
yeah.
you were already Q-cleared.
Yeah. Now, I've driven down to Vegas from Reno, and you go right past the, you know, right past Mercury, and the entry is a long drive. You from the highway to a checkpoint way out there. And so you had to make that trek. Did you actually live on the Mercury site?
Oh yeah.
And was it in construction then, or was it already testing bombs?
A lot of it was. They were testing bombs, but it was still in construction.
Still in construction.
It was the how we lived was very crude, harsh.
Really.
We lived in tents with dirt floors.
No kidding.
Oh, yeah.
In the Mercury site.
Wow. Yeah.
You got better treatment over there in the Marshall Islands. So what did you do at Mercury? Did you build the towers?
Same thing, and took up different things. I was given a 110 Cleveland trenching machine to operate, because by that time I'd been on trenching machines and learned how to operate them. So I did that for quite a while.
I see.
Run the trenching machine. We dig these communication trenches. In some of those trenches, now the most I could dig was 5.5 feet deep. And a lot of that ground was as hard as concrete.
Is that because
of the caliche?
Is that because of the testing that went on?
No, it was just a natural ground there of clay that had hardened and called caliche.
Yeah.
And they'd take these great big caterpillar trenchers, or not trenchers, but can't think of them. And they'd have things on the back that went down in the ground, and then they'd go along and they'd rip.
Uh-huh.
They'd rip that stuff apart to where when you went through there with a trencher, you could dig it out and get some kind of a trench there.
Yeah. What's the lay of the land there? You can't see it really from the road.
The most of the lay of the land there is absolutely flat.
Flat. And is it surrounded by mountains?
Surrounded by mountains.
Okay. And then there's this tower, I guess, in the middle of all this, right, where they did the above-ground testing?
Yeah, the towers were here and there and over there.
Oh.
But eventually they stopped using towers for one reason or another and started putting them all down underground.
Underground because of the radiation.
And way
leaks,
down
right?
underground. Bill, I mean, hundreds of feet down underground.
Uh-huh.
Bill, I'm curious to know when you were there at Mercury, about what year that was.
1950-51.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
1952.
Well, that was the
that
beginning
hole
of it, wasn't it?
They blasted there or whatever. I was somewhat involved with the government, with my engineers. I had two of them that worked on the development of that hole, which after I got out of college, was probably down 8,700 feet.
It was. And you say it's mineralized in a very special way. Before and even, and then after, especially it changed the mineralization.
A lot of mineral crystals are on the walls of that hole that are radioactive crystals, which are very unusual.
Yeah, it had to have changed the underground structure, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it must have caused some severe shaking, I suppose, in the nearby towns like Las Vegas.
Well, yeah,
had to have been able to feel that, right?
You could feel it. I've been in Las Vegas when they set a big one off and it'd shake the ground.
Yeah. Now, were you ever on site when they tested one of the bombs?
Many times.
Many times. Now, had they learned anything from the time you were in the Marshalls to there? I mean, did they have you a little further away from the explosion?
No, not that I remember. most of those bombs, they felt it was safe enough that I'm positive some people were as close as 4 miles, but a lot of them were maybe at 6 and 7 miles.
Yeah. Were you up? Were you on the flat ground, or were you up on the mountains overlooking?
Most of the time on flat ground, but then there was some ground higher that they built observation areas for the VIPs that come in from the cities and newspapers, and they had chairs there, and they could sit there.
They could sit
and watch
there.
It. Oh, man. With goggles.
Goggles, yeah. You know, at least they gave you goggles, huh?
Yeah, I had a thrill that you normally don't get. Some people would scare them, say, I don't want to do that. When they detonated the world's first... that wasn't a hydrogen bomb. It was a large atomic bomb.
Yeah.
They didn't have enough glasses, goggles, to go around. For some reason, they were short. And we were all on ships in the lagoon.
This is in the Marshalls.
Yeah. And so we were given instructions how to handle it without goggles. We were to sit down. They had this count going all the time.
Uh-huh.
You know, they knew exactly where they were until they pushed the button. Anyway, when they got to 30, you were supposed to be set on the ground with the explosion going to be behind you, usually 15 miles. And you had your head in your lap with your eyes completely closed and your hands over your eyes this way. And you were told to stay that way until an all signal is announced. And then you can get up.
Wow.
And so I was always one to really follow instructions because they meant business.
Yeah, for sure.
But there were some kids that... and we're all a bunch of kids, young 20s, and that couldn't wait to see the fireball.
Yeah.
That took their hands away too soon, and they may be blind today.
They could be blind today. Yeah, and had to be a similar experience there in Nevada as well. But they probably had enough goggles by that time, hopefully. But when you saw that mushroom cloud, that must have been really awe-inspiring. Did it take your breath away?
It was exciting to see it, and they go up,
up,
and they curl, and they go up.
Yeah.
And those bombs, the bigger ones then, would send that cloud up. The biggest number I ever heard was 87,000 feet.
Amazing, amazing. You know, what was the sound like for you, Bill? I mean, was it ear-shattering kind of a sound? Had to be, huh?
You didn't hear the sound right away.
You didn't?
No, depending how far away from everyone.
Yeah.
I remember one kid one day, he said, it was all over. Gee, is that all there is to it? And about that time, that sound wave hit him and knocked him right across that ship.
No, man. So did you get ear damage from it as well?
I didn't, but I'm sure some people did.
You were very, very fortunate, man.
Hey, Bill. Did they tell you what megatons that they were using, or did you know?
No, they didn't. Well, they did after the test.
After the test,
it's written today. You can see each bomb. I guess they've got mercury at the headquarters. It shows every bomb ever detonated out there. And the megatons of every single one of them.
Let's take a break here, guys. We'll come back for our last segment here on Old Tales of Nevada. And what a great conversation we're having, so stay tuned.
All of us at Shoeman's Custom Cycle are ready to get you and your Harley ready for the road. From oil and tire changes to high-performance engine upgrades and dyno tuning, we at Shoeman's have got you covered with experienced factory-certified mechanics and a full-service machine shop loaded with parts and accessories. Shoeman's Custom Cycle has been serving Northern Nevada since 1988. So ride on down to Shoeman's Custom Cycle at 275 East 4th Street in downtown Reno.
Shoeman's Custom Cycle. We're the biker's bike shop.
Somewhere in Time is the place to find what will be treasured for all time. A store full of the unexpected, with one of the largest beer and sports memorabilia collections on the West Coast. Vintage toys, casino and brothel memorabilia, Venton glassware, kerosene lamps from the 1800s, Sun Purple glassware, vintage neon, new and enlarged collections throughout the store. Have fun with the whole family and check out all the inventory in the store. Find the unexpected. That'll be treasured for all time at Somewhere in Time.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is the home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel. So stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
Buy Nevada First Gift Shop and Visitor Center at the Reno Town Mall is the place to buy local Nevada-owned products. There is over 4,000 square feet of unique items to choose from. Art, jewelry, books, music, inventions, clothing, candy, pottery, toys, even Nevada-made wine and more. Why, you can even purchase a gift basket full of Nevada-owned products. Buy Nevada First Gift Shop, located at the Reno Town Mall, 4001 Virginia Street in Reno. Buy local first.
Back here for our last segment of Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. And boy, oh boy, we've had a great conversation here with Bill Quick so far about the nuclear energy testing here in Nevada, down at the Mercury test site, as well as the Marshall Islands. He was there for it all. You were mentioning that VIPs would come out from Las Vegas. Were these like movie stars or entertainers or government people,
military
folks?
Well, I'm sure a lot of them were entertainers and people who had... the new people that could they could jump into an automobile and ride out the desert road and go all the way.
Yeah. Did you ever get a chance? They didn't belong there, but then the
AEC, Atomic Energy Commission, wanted a certain amount of people have nothing to watch what was going on.
Yeah. Did you ever get a chance to meet any of them? Any of the VIPs? Any of the stars?
No. You could meet all the movie stars you wanted in Las Vegas.
Yeah,
they were there all the time.
Yeah, that's right. They played in the bars there, didn't they? Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. So you stayed there for a couple of years, in and out, right? Doing
about a year and a half.
Year and a half.
In and out, yeah.
Yeah, and finally got enough of, you know, you've seen one, you've seen them all, right?
Well, they started hiring in Las Vegas, and believe it or not, not only were the conditions better, but so was the money.
All right.
You didn't have to go way out there. You go to Las Vegas, and you're already queue cleared, so you could go and sign up and go right to work.
Go right to work, and you could do what? What were you building, the casinos?
Everything out there was the same as in the islands.
Oh, okay.
You know, or just built, but they were building it close to the city.
Closer to the city.
We were probably 55, 60 miles out of Las Vegas.
Okay.
To build that stuff where they felt it was safe enough.
So you could build the stuff and then they'd haul it out to the test site?
Not necessarily. Build it right on the site and detonated it.
Oh, okay.
But it was 55 miles away from where unauthorized human beings were stationed.
I see.
Yeah.
All right. So... Bill, what do you think about working for the atomic energy? The bomb is sophisticated now, and it's because of your work and all of the work of those involved. You have these countries with all of these bombs. You ever give any thought to that, pro con? How do you feel about all of that? Is that something you even concern yourself with?
I think you thought about some of that all the time. That it was dangerous, destructive. You see, what we were doing then, we had to keep our program going to keep ahead of the Russians.
Right.
Otherwise, we were going to shut the program down in 1950, but didn't.
Yeah.
Because the Russians would have just walked right over us and kept going, made bigger bombs, and maybe conquered the world.
Mm-hmm.
This is what they wanted to do.
Yeah. Right.
But we kept building more and more and bigger, and it kept the Russians at bay.
Yeah.
To where that never happened.
Yeah. So in that respect, it was something that was necessary that had to be done. I remember being in school. You and I are about the same age. And mm-hmm. remember being in school and they were doing the air raid.
Get under drills. the desk and hold your head and whatever. Bill, I'm curious to know whether on these projects, was there any publication material that you saw that the government was making up that was either made available or was around the area in the headquarters building?
There was articles in the Las Vegas newspapers constantly mm-hmm. of what was going on. They never told any secrets, but you knew what was going on.
Yeah.
My attorney, who was involved at that time with that effort, I was the attorney for 28 different countries in the United States, and the publications that used to be made, you see, you could buy them from the GAO book office in Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
And when I'd go to Washington to those embassies up there to take care of the foreign people, I'd go in there and buy the stuff on the history of the nuclear activities or whatever right in there, and it had all that on the blasts as they're blasting underground going down, the information on it, and then suddenly, no more information.
No
at
more.
All. And now they don't have any more at all.
And now it's top secret, right?
Yeah.
Yes, it was then, but I mean, it's probably even more so now. So now, going back to that Mercury site there, Bill, did they ever open it up to the public at some point so that you can go take tours of
oh,
that?
Oh, yeah.
You can. You can actually go in there now?
Yeah.
It's safe now.
It's even open today.
It is.
But you'll see less today because they have destroyed, covered up, cleaned up to where so much of it's gone.
Oh,
but they furnished two big, like, Greyhound buses every day.
Yeah, they do.
For years.
Oh, no kidding.
They take whole bunches of people out and show them all the main sites.
That's how you get out there.
Vegas, yeah, you can't just drive out there in your car, right? You have to sign up somewhere.
Oh, no.
Where do you do that? I mean, do you go to the casinos in Vegas and do it, or is there a,
we'll do a casino show out there. We'll do it in Washington, but it's, from what I hear, a ghost town now. I mean, it's pretty much all shut down.
Yeah. In other words, if we went out there, I mean, there would probably be no activity. Like if we wanted to go out and do a show there.
Well, no. Our best bet is to go out there, you know, with the military.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
Where the buses went out of Vegas to the Atomic Proving Grounds was well known, advertised.
Oh.
And this is where people would go with their family early in the morning to make sure they sign up and they got a seat.
Is and, that the checkpoint you see from the
two
road?
Two buses would go out in the morning and two buses would go out in the afternoon.
I see.
And this went on for years.
Years, yeah. Is that the checkpoint I see in the distance there? That long road that goes off the highway and you go way out.
I think that's right, though, when Bill said that a lot of this was done for security of the United States.
Yeah.
That's really what it was all about.
Sure, absolutely.
That's the reason for having done any of it.
Yeah.
They were looking at it as security through strength of defense.
Yeah, yeah. Now, was Mercury the only test site in Nevada? Somebody mentioned to me one time that they did something up in the Fallon area, too. Is that true?
That's true.
It is true.
They did some tests.
Well, you know where the
out of
Navy
the state,
base is
even.
Out of the state.
Oh, yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah.
I didn't know the
Navy base is. There used to be a facility not far from there that was a big laboratory for the Navy working on it.
Really? Did they have not as big a bomb, though, right? I mean,
they
must have been smaller devices, right? Because you don't hear about the Fallon area like you do the
Navy likes to keep secret their methods of using the missiles coming out of the submarines from the Air Force. It's using a different method, and the Army has their ideas about stuff, too. So if you get involved with the people that control the armed forces, they're involved with each branch of it with the nuclear. But our problem is they're bringing nuclear in across the Mexican border fairly regularly, and then amassing amounts of it in Texas, which is my home state, which I don't appreciate at all.
Yeah. Now, let me ask you, Bill, do they keep track of you at all as far as your health and, you know, do you guys have like an alumni association where the government,
it was very relaxed. It wasn't until way inside of the test that they started putting film badges on you so they could record how much gamma rays you got.
Right, right.
But they didn't do that for a long time.
Is there any compensation for you guys that worked on
this? I don't think so.
You don't think so?
No.
Wow. Well, you weren't military. You were civilian,
I
right?
was civilian.
The whole time. Yeah.
Most of us that worked were civilians.
Yeah, because, you know, we who were in the military, like me, Air Force, I was in the Air Force. I mean, I can go to the VA and get health care, and there's different benefits for those.
I can't get any of that.
But you were in a more dangerous situation than I ever was, you know?
Now, they've changed the laws and rules on that today to where I'm sure there's help to be given to those people that worked on the project and got more radiation than they should have.
Because probably, and we don't want to be negative here, but the government probably knew a lot more about radiation effects than they were letting on to you guys. So you guys were in there innocent victims of this radiation effect, and it seems to me that there should be some compensation for people who worked on those projects, right, Ura?
Well, I think, like he says, it would have been if it had been more recent, like Vietnam, where the guys were out there.
Agent Orange or whatever.
Yeah,
the biggest shots were out in the islands.
Yeah, yeah.
Out of Vegas.
Not in Vegas.
And when they came back, they got through with them. They still had some big shots, but not that big.
Not that big. Well, the people on those islands have actually sued the government.
Most of all the knowledge came from underground testing.
Underground testing.
And underground testing for the Russians and the Chinese.
Yeah.
And
anybody else.
The Iranians were underground testing, too.
Yeah, yeah. But I noticed the ones in the Marshall Islands, the residents of the Marshall Islands, they have sued the government and are either trying to get compensation or have been compensated for the destruction of their environment there.
They moved men back. They moved natives back on the islands.
They did. Yeah.
Sooner than they should have.
Ah, okay.
And they were contaminated.
I got you.
And actually, there were a couple of those islands that were so radioactive that were dangerous. And it seemed like the people, they were always somebody going, slipping out there on a boat and walking on them, that they finally capped them.
Wow.
Took and built caps out of concrete over the tops of the whole damn island.
Wow.
To where
amazing. Amazing. Well, Bill, listen, we're down to the end of the show, and we really want to thank you for allowing us to pick your brain here on what you did in this testing of these nuclear bombs and hydrogen bombs. It's just an amazing experience that you'll never forget, and we're happy to get it on audio and visual. So down the road, if people want to hear what it was like, they can watch our show.
It's an important part of it.
And you do bring us pride living here in Nevada, having people like you to tell stories like this. So appreciate it very much. And Uroy, thanks for being with us and supporting the show as usual. And we want to thank the audience as well for being with us each week, up around 250 episodes now. And we want to invite you back next week for another episode of Old Tales in Nevada. In the meantime, for Uroy, for Bill, myself, John O'Brien, have a great Nevada day.